If new, leave a message at the beep.
Hey, man. So you remember when... remember, like, back in high school, when we first became friends, we agreed we would do anything for each other. And, you know, that included me hooking you up with jobs and girlfriends and, you know, herpes and, you know, sure, maybe your house got burned down. Okay, it happens, you know. It was insured. I mean, your stuff wasn't, but you didn't have renters. That's kind of your fault, but your landlord's house was covered. I mean, it's all, that happens. We're here for each other. We care about each other. We're good friends. And I just want you to know, if you need anything, and I mean anything, I will be there for you. And I know, by the same token, you'll be there for me. So, you know, I need a bone marrow transfusion. And I know that's like one of the most invasive and painful and dangerous surgeries. It's the one with the highest likelihood to kill you. But, buddy, I don't know how to tell you this. I need it. I don't want it. I need it. You see, God, this is embarrassing. This is difficult to talk about. You see, something happened with me. I got a stripper pregnant, and she's requesting a paternity test, and the only way to change my DNA is by getting a bone marrow transplant. So I need that from you, so that next month or 3 months down the road, when I finally do get pulled over and arrested for failure to appear, they will, you know, swab my, I don't know, testicles, anus, I don't know where they swab, and my DNA will not match the baby. I need this from you, man. My life depends on it. All right. What's his name's birthday? Don't forget to send a card. Okay, buddy. Talk to you soon. Bye.
Welcome back, everybody, to the Brian K. White 4K Glossy News, Review, Entertainment, all that good stuff podcast. I am your host, of course, Brian K. White. Joining me in studio this week, once again, is the awesome Jason Jones. I hope he'll be back for more, but he insists that I pay him with goats. And I don't know where you live, but the secondary market for goats around here is really limited. So we're going to talk about technology. We're going to talk about how technology has changed. We're going to talk about just, you know, all manner of crazy stuff. And rumor has it, we're going to have a good time doing it. We're also going to talk about some of the clever things you can do with a funeral. Some of the absurd places you can have a funeral. And he should know, he's lost people, I've lost people, we're both orphans. It's you know, won't you think of the children? I won't. I don't. But if I did, I would ask you to as well think about the children. So with that said, you know, I don't see a whole lot of reason to go too crazy on the intro. I should say, for those of you watching along, you'll notice that the very intro segment, the one I do over the fake phone call to J-Dog, I finally have a better, more appropriate video, and maybe I'll, you know, do it again in the future. I'm sure I will. And for those of you sticking around to the end, of whom I hope there are literally twos of you, There should be a new video at the end as well. I tell you guys, it's not just about quantity. It's about, well, it's about quantity. But sometimes I throw some quality in the mix. So with that said, let's get on to this week's sponsors. This week's podcast is brought to you in part by Amazon Returns. Amazon Returns, for when the description is in no way comparable to what you ordered. Amazon Returns, for when what you bought doesn't work in the first place. Amazon Returns, you know, they'll ban you for life eventually, but when you get junk, you just gots to send it back. All right, well, you know, good enough. Let's get started.
Love's my last testing and dentals.
So we're back with another segment about our last will and testament and what we think would be a really good, meaningful way to hold, you know, to have our wishes fulfilled in the afterlife. And last week, Jason here had a really great idea for a possible venue.
Yeah, Jason, a venue.
Where would you like your funeral to be held?
Freaking a water theme park, like Wild Waves. Like a Wild Norse Waves funeral. So what you do is you just put it out on the water, you know, on the wave machine.
Oh, is that the one where they put you on a raft and then set it on fire with bow and arrow?
And push it out. The only problem is you would have to, like, time it, because I think it's all computer controlled now.
Sure.
And when the waves, you got to get him out there before the wave machine starts back up. When it starts back up, it's going to come billowing back in, like, fire and rage.
and if I remember, you know, wave pools correctly, there's a sweet spot. So it would start coming back, and then it would get into the sweet spot where it crests.
Right. Yes.
And then I assume
eventually it would go around in a circle, and then it would probably be beached. It would probably fall apart by then, so the body would wash up on shore.
Well, I think it would, it would capsize it.
Right.
And the flaming corpse. Is formaldehyde flammable? That would be hysterical.
They don't have to use formaldehyde. They could use gasoline.
Oh, I don't think gasoline's a good preservative, though.
Oh, I'm sure it would work fine.
And the fun thing is, if it capsizes you'd hear a whistle blow and the dude would dive in and...
Yeah, he'd be like, no, we want this to happen. No, it's okay.
We planned this. No, you're not bringing him back.
No.
He is beyond saving.
Not bringing him back.
I mean, oh, God, not he's giving happen. Him mouth to mouth. It's so gross.
Yeah.
And then it would wash up. If you're doing the theme park thing, I know Wild Waves has a big coaster. What you could do is prop my body in the coaster and let the family take turns going through and getting their picture taken. Just put me up front. And, you know, I think ideally the way I should be taxidermied is with my eyes open and my mouth like,
Right, like you're having fun.
Like I'm having fun.
Yeah.
Like I'm enjoying the roller coaster for the last time. And all of you guys, you know, you're going to be there. And if you want a chance at being in the will, you will ride the coaster with me. Because, come on, guys, this is my wish.
It's a prerequisite.
This is my wish. What would you want to do in the theme park?
I think actually, like, what I would want to do is get my whole family together and go to the Disneyland, you know, the wave, I don't know what it's called. I can't remember now. Or Splash Mountain. So you get the whole family in Splash Mountain, and then my body's in the front like this, and then everybody's behind you, and you're doing this, and like you could duct tape my arms up or something. So it's like, here's my last ride, you know?
And you could, you know, duct tape them straight up and do Space Mountain and see if you hit anything.
Right.
You know what you should do? You're already at Wild Waves. Because, you know, let's not go crazy with this. Obviously.
Let's not get ridiculous.
Disneyland is, you're getting impractical at that point.
Yeah.
No, what you got to do is, since you've got the park to yourself, you could also do it where it's not to yourself, but I think they'd probably ask you to leave, which is BS because you paid for that ticket for me.
You did.
And so it's fine. It's fine. You shouldn't have to pay for my ticket because I'm more of a prop at this point than a person. But no, what you should do is go to the big slide. One last time on the big slide.
Oh, yeah, with the carpet. And you should set the body on fire too while you do that.
That would, how awesome would, and people, the family could stand up above at the platform and look down and just watch this flaming wreck of a body go through it
and
all.
And you don't have to pay for cremation. By the end of it, it's done.
I don't know if it would quite be done. The outside would definitely be done, but the neat thing is you could see it like go through the tubes, and the tubes are lighting up.
Yeah, and it's a start on the cremation, so it's like a journey to it.
It's a head start.
Right.
You could probably get a discount on the cremation.
You could just have them bring in like a 25,000,
BTU.
Firing kiln at the end, and then you throw in there, and then you all get like...
Well, they've got a pizza oven. The wood-fired pizza.
Pretty much. Something that would just give it so your ashes, dust to dust, and then you could hand it out, too.
And like then...
A little... Right.
Blow it on everybody.
Right, or just hand it out in vials or something. Or
that'd be like, vile.
Yeah.
That'd be vile. Because as a kid, I never got to enjoy the concession stand. Buy me a bunch of food. Just stuff it in me. Just if you can't get it down my throat with like a chopsticks or something, just kind of pushing it, you could just undo a staple or two.
Yeah, or like these days, like what's the big rage right now for food for get-togethers?
What?
A taco truck.
Oh,
so you have a taco truck, and then you have the body... filled with candy for the children, so the grandfather
right.
gives to give something to the children,
right.
and instead you fill the body with candy, and then the kids beat the living bejesus out of the body. You don't need the body anymore; the spirit's gone, and then the candy falls out, and they can bring it home.
That would be actually, very cathartic for a lot of people, because I don't know if I've told you this, but I beat my children savagely. I mean, I beat them in
2016. That's what you
right.
have to do.
I beat them in Call of Duty. I beat them
right.
in Monopoly.
Yep.
And
it
they're terrible.
Character.
They are terrible at Scrabble.
Yeah.
And I mean, I play made up words and they don't know.
But
it.
You're like the ninja master. You keep
right.
beating them down in this, and then
right.
someday they will beat you.
Exactly.
And that's when you
exactly.
know that they're ready.
And yes.
For
and
more video
ideally,
games.
I would like them to savagely beat me when I'm not alive. Because, at that point, I mean, literally.
Yeah, it's like a metaphor.
Right.
You know?
And when they're done, they can say, you know what? This is beating a dead horse. So put a horse mask on me. Or make the pinata horse-shaped.
Or, yeah, they could cover you in the pinata confetti, so it's just kind of your shape.
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
And then the candy comes out, and it's right in front of the taco truck. So when they're done, too, then you can hang it on top of the taco truck with, like, some lights or something, and then everybody gets tacos.
What I think would be even better, and besides, first of all, who doesn't like tacos? And a taco buffet?
Speaking of, do you know that this year that Cinco de Mayo and Taco Tuesday are the same day?
Huh. When is Cinco de Mayo this year?
I can't remember the exact date, but I know that it's on Taco Tuesday.
Mm.
We've been preparing for this for years.
I know he'll deny it, but one time J-Dog literally asked me, when is Cinco de Mayo? He was in high school, so apparently he didn't habla much Espanol.
That's usually the days that I get pulled over for some reason when I drive
home
late
don't.
At night.
I don't. I get pulled over early on the morning of the 6th.
Hmm.
I don't know why. It's like, guys, it's not even Cinco de Mayo. And then I barf.
Right.
And then I open the door and fall out on the ground.
Yeah.
And they're like, you shouldn't be driving. I'm like, well, I certainly am too drunk to walk.
Now, last time I got pulled over on Cinco de Mayo, it's like I had my lowrider... Accord, remember back in the day, and the thing, I was avoiding potholes, so I'm like going around, and he's like, you're driving erratically, and I said, well, it's slammed, I'm avoiding the potholes, and he's like, oh, so you do have reaction time, blah blah blah, Cinco de Mayo. I'm like, I don't even know what that is yet. I'm like 18, like, give me another 2 years,
right,
we'll see what happens,
but
like,
but definitely make a note of my license plate, because you will see me again,
right, on Cinco de Mayo, driving straight but drunk as shit.
right.
Yeah.
Right. That's actually, so I don't know. I think the theme park, the Wild Waves theme park, it's not a bad idea.
I think you could do it.
And the thing is, yeah, the body's going to get pretty gross once it gets wet. But
and
again,
burn.
Yeah, but again, if you're going to do the Viking funeral, the send off.
Yeah.
I mean, why not? And what kid would not like to play with the flaming bow and arrow, with the flaming arrows.
Oh, exactly. Yeah, have the youngest one do it.
Of course. Well, you line up and you go youngest to oldest.
Right.
And it'd be, hopefully It gets a little bit burnt before the wave machine comes back on.
Well, and that'll throw them off because they were expecting it to go out and like stay, and then all of a sudden here it comes back.
Oh,
you know?
Here comes Dad.
Right.
Dad's
then you have like
back.
A reward. Forever pulls the body out first. I don't know, gets like the Monopoly cards from Safeway or something. Like 10 of them. You never know, it could be the winner. You never know. Or just a lotto, a scratch ticket or something.
No, I think the Monopoly. But the Monopoly ones are free.
That's true. Yeah.
And also worth free.
Right. And you're spending a lot of money on like the Wild Waves thing. And I know you can do it because I know high schools and their senior party years or whatever.
Yeah.
They rented the whole thing. Like, yeah. If you're in the Northwest, everybody knows Wild Waves. But those water theme parks with that wave machine are in every state.
Yeah. I mean, if you want to take some of these ideas or all of them, I permit that. Although I should mention that since we've recorded this, this is now technically copyright, and you should probably not be a dick and put us in your will. I'm just saying.
Yeah,
it's
like cash.
Cash is fine. Stocks are okay.
My wife would like more Monopoly cards, so I mean, hey, if you want.
If you've got Monopoly tickets, you can certainly send them to us.
It's getting kind of old now because I mean, you get so many, and you just keep getting the repeats and. You can do an exchange party or something, I guess.
I don't shop at Safeway because it's not the closest and it's not the most convenient. The closest place to us is the food bank.
Right. And, every time I go in there, though, it makes me so mad because I'm like, the customer's always right, right?
Mm-hmm,
I'm like,
mm-hmm.
I got these food stamps. I want cigarettes and I want booze. And they say no. And I'm like, this is a free country, right?
Right.
If it's a free country... then I should be able, through the Fifth Amendment, right, to be able to get cigarettes and booze with food stamps.
Mm-hmm. This is America.
This is America.
But no, I don't mean food stamps. I mean the food bank. And we don't, you know, we don't qualify. But
do they have booze and cigarettes at the food bank?
I haven't gotten any yet, but I will certainly check. I would love to see him come in with some cooking sherry. But no, what we do, since we don't, we can't. But it's the closest food place to here is we roll the little old ladies because I mean they what are they gonna do, stop you? It's like, oh, you stole my food, girlfriend, that ain't your food,
right?
Not until you get home.
Yeah.
And I'm bigger than you and I'm stronger than you and I'm younger than you, and that is my leftover 3-day old sushi.
You could always, like, if you want a little more fresh too, is like you go to retirement center and then hijack the Meals on Wheels truck.
Oh, you know how many meals you'd get out of that?
Yeah, you're going to need to salt stuff, though, because everything on those is really bland.
Oh, wow.
But, I mean, you just get a big thing of Johnny's seasoning salt, you're good.
What I do is I put on prosthetic makeup. It costs, like, $500 to have the makeup guy come out and do it. But then I can get
one... You can spend that much at Costco in a day.
And so then I go to the old... And I make my loop around the old folks' homes. And I just change my outfit each time. And I know they're where they go with the Meals on Wheels. So I kind of follow them around. Mm-hmm. And I get so stuffed with Salisbury steak and
apple
potatoes.
Sauce. Yeah, and instant mashed potatoes.
Mm-hmm.
That, you know, mystery bean stuff. It's a lot like cafeteria food, but there's even less salt.
Wow.
You know?
Well, cafeteria food is like 30% salt.
Oh, maybe that's the problem.
Yeah, it's... they actually start with a salt base.
They can even make
pizza. And then they add...
Remember that?
I like the pizza.
It was square, and they burnt the shit out of it.
Oh, ours was never
burnt.
Every
time.
Oh,
and then there was always one kid that had the... Like, I'd bring lunch most of the time because I didn't like cafeteria food. Every day until fourth grade, somebody would puke right after lunch.
Wow.
The cafeteria food.
Huh.
I remember like eating this pizza and it was like burnt and I almost threw up. But it was never the kids that brought their lunch. It was always the cafeteria food. Some kid would projectile vomit the mooey milk and the crafty carrots or whatever it was. It'd just be a mess. It'd be everywhere. And then that guy come in with the powder.
I don't know, but that did not happen at my school.
Oh,
no, what we had that was great is this is a better segment for my crazy mom, but my mom would not give me enough lunch money, and unless I was working, you know, and she's like, well, then, you know, but it's fine, whatever. So what I would do is, and then we reached a point where she just cut me off from lunch money altogether, and she said, tough shit, buy your own lunch, you know, because
at what, 7 years old?
No. No, it was great. We got free lunch until I was in high school because she would fill out the paperwork saying that we were poor. Do you remember the house we lived in?
Yes, I do.
Do you think my parents were ever poor? No, that's how she was able to amass so much money. Yeah, 3,000 square foot house on the water.
Yeah, that's not,
That's not a plausible story.
No, I'm just thinking at seven, like she pocketed it and was like, no, you're not even getting that anymore. So you get the crappy Star Wars action figures that nobody went, and you can only get half a lunch.
It was great.
It's miracle you are who you are today, my friend.
I'm a terrible person. So what I would do in high school is, and this is not a joke, I would sweet talk the lunch lady. There was one lunch lady in particular. She was probably in her mid-30s, and I was a handsome devil at 15, 16, and she would always compliment me on my hair, which looking back is just creepy.
Was she all like, hoagies and grinders, navy beans, navy beans?
So I would wait until the line was done, and as they're packing up, I'd go, hey, I don't have any money. Can I get lunch?
Oh.
And she'd give me like 2 pieces of pizza. And it was great because normally you have to take one of everything, even though you're going to throw it all in the trash.
Right.
But she would just be like, oh, what do you want? And she'd just throw it on a tray and be like, okay, you rascal, get out of here with your beautiful hair.
Right. That's exactly what she was thinking.
It's what she would say.
Right.
So, I mean, I can only judge her thoughts by her words and actions. And I do mean actions.
And just on a quick side note, he was telling me earlier that he did have a Star Wars action figure of Luke Skywalker. Does anybody want to guess which one it was?
And we'll give you a hint.
It's the crappiest one out of all the Luke Skywalkers you could get, action figures. That's the hint we'll give you.
You can
put a comment down on the post or something of what you think that one is. And we both know which one, and you all know which one is the worst action figure of Luke Skywalker.
Because I told Jason, I said, look, there was this listicle of the worst Star Wars action figures, and I had half of them.
Yeah.
And he was like, and so I told him some of the ones I had. One of the ones I had was the guy who took care of Jabba the Hutt's Rancor.
Rancor monster.
The Rancor handler. Monster. The guy. The big fat guy.
The fat piece of,
And it's like, this is not, first of all, it did not fit in my Darth Vader head collection thing.
No, it's too fat.
Yeah, it was the wrong shape.
It looks like we do now without a shirt on. It's just gross.
Do you want to see that? Because
not when you're 10.
Yeah.
No.
So I said, no, I just had the worst ones. And he's like, well, you know, you've got to have Darth Vader and Luke Skywalker. So I didn't get no Darth Vader.
Skywalker had that yellow lightsaber that came out.
That's so classic. I never even saw that one.
Right.
I don't even... That's weird.
I feel bad for you. Every child should have had that one.
So I said, well, no, I never got a Darth Vader. I never got a Boba Fett. I never got a... well, I got a Luke, but I got the worst Luke ever.
Yeah.
And Jason said, was it... I said, which one do you think it was? And he said, was it such and such? And I said, of course it was.
Yeah. After 30 years, that's... instantly, I was like, it's that one. We all know which one that is.
You know what they should have had?
Hint, you can't move the head.
You know what would have been... You know what they should have had was the Luke with detachable hand.
Yeah. I wonder if they ever made that. I mean, I know the first ones, like later on, you had a lightsaber you put in their hand, but it was stupid. You lose and fall. I always like the one that came out of the hand because it's like he's turning it on.
Right.
And it was yellow, and I'm like, this isn't right. And then I guess that one's, like, worth money because they switched to blue. The only problem is that it had, like, a really small end to make it look like it's longer, even though it's inside, and my cat chewed all of them off. Cat just loved the end of those lightsabers.
Not a Star Wars fan. Not a Star Wars fan, but in fairness, the key demo for Star Wars was never cats.
Oh.
And, you know, it's frustrating to me because toys will say on them, you know, for ages 12 and up, for ages 8 and up, for ages 3 and up, but they never specify the age of cats and dogs you should have.
Yeah. I mean, the cat should be over 5 before he chews on the toy, right?
You would think. You would think.
That should be on there. I mean, that's a lawsuit just waiting to happen.
I think cats and dogs are underrepresented.
Yeah, they've really overlooked this one.
In the judicial system entirely.
Right. Yeah.
I mean, how is it? Explain this to me. Did you know a dog can testify in court?
I can see that happening.
A drug dog.
Yeah, or like yes or no, like the hoof, the dogs on the hooves, but you know.
So, do you know that? You don't have dogs. I have dogs. They have hooves.
Okay. Okay. Are they cloven? Or?
Yes, God, into five unique segments.
It hurts when you don't click their claws and they jump up on your lap. Can you imagine a hoof like jumping up? And like a big dog with hooves. Like just a goat. He just jumps up in your lap. He's a lap goat. And just smashes your nuts.
No, God, no goat.
And he's like...
And goats love standing on things. So what
your lap.
That's the thing is, well, they'd start with your lap and the next thing they're on your shoulders and it's like, stop climbing things, goat.
Pellets start coming out everywhere.
I think the reason people don't have pet goats in their house, and it's not because, although George Bush did ruin the whole my pet goat concept by reading that book. The reason is they would eat your furniture.
They eat everything and then they poop everywhere. There's just certain animals like... There's a level of eating and pooping in your house that is an acceptable level. Puppies, a little bit of poop and stuff, you know, okay, that goes that way. Cats, they use a litter box. Dogs, they grow out of it unless they have an accident once in a while. But, I mean, a goat, he's just going to eat and poop everywhere. You leave a goat in your house for like 3 hours, you come back, it's a disaster. Just not a good idea for a pet.
So out of curiosity, why would I leave a goat alone in my house for 3 hours?
Scientific experiment. I don't know.
That would yield data.
Yeah, you could make you get some really interesting photos that people would probably look at online.
I think that would be a neat science fair project for the kids.
It'd be good to do to somebody else, so you don't have to worry about it.
And you know, set up some GoPros around the house so you can see, so you can later go back and document what they got up to.
Yeah, do it when your neighbors are out of vacation. Break in their house and throw a goat in.
I don't know if you'd want to document that. Maybe what you should do is.
You could say that you filmed in Canada.
Airbnb.
Yeah?
Yeah, rent somebody else's house or apartment for the weekend.
Right.
And, you know, use a prepaid credit card. And I can see literally no downside to this idea.
No, not at all. No. It's a science experiment. I mean, that's just what you tell them. I mean, the cops show up and stuff. It's like, hey, this is a science experiment, okay?
Do you hate science? Are you one of those people who hates science?
Yeah, you don't want to hate
science. Officer, what are you, the law police?
Right.
Yeah. And actually, as it turns out...
We have rights.
I thought this was America.
Yeah. If I want to break into my neighbor's house... And do a science experiment to see what the goat can do to the house. You should be able to do that. That's how we learn things, people. That's how we learn things.
I don't think...
Freedom of expression. I would call it artistic.
I don't think the police in this country understand how science is made.
No. No, they don't. They don't. Otherwise, they'd be on the rocket ships right now. But they're not.
Right. Do you think the police, when they discovered penicillin, do you think the police came in and said, no, wait, that's moldy?
They probably did. What the hell you got in this Petri dish for crying out loud? You're not going to put that on me. That'll kill me.
No, I'm injecting it inside your body to save you. Right. Doesn't that sound logical? Mm-hmm. Hey, it doesn't have to. This is science.
That's right. Yeah. Science. Just remember. So that's the theme at the end of the day. I mean, yeah, that's where this was going the whole time.
This has been a lot of people don't know this about the podcast, but we actually script every word in advance. And this 22-minute segment has been from memory. And this part is also part of the script, which
it takes days to memorize this,
which
too.
I wrote down right here. See?
Right.
Mm-hmm. It's. You know, it's we try to make it feel improvised, but we're just that good
that
we can do it in one take.
Yeah.
And or fake radio.
Yeah.
It's just TV in that it's not on a TV unless you connect YouTube to a TV. And it's just radio in that you can listen to it through speakers, but not on the radio.
Yeah, but even when it's a TV, it's going through like a PlayStation or something else, and then it's going to your TV. So it's not like, I don't know, I mean, we could maybe...
Well, we use web TV for everything.
Yeah. What we should do is broadcast on a UHF channel. See if anybody can pick it up.
Do you know how much trouble you would get in having an unlicensed UHF transmitter broadcasting?
Didn't they? There was that movie, UHF.
He bought, or his aunt or grandma left, so he had a station.
We don't need no stinking badgers, yeah. Good times.
All right. I think we should move on to the next segment.
Yeah.
Tech
technology. Oh my gosh. So here we are in studio with Jason Jones of all people. Oh my God.
Yo, like Alfio. Yo!
Gordon. I call him Gordon because we're close.
Where's your cat?
I like lasagna. Oh wait, that's Garfield.
Yeah, I do like lasagna though.
So we're talking about technology. Jason had a great topic, and it was how technology has changed since we were in school 23 years ago. God, yeah. Back then, Jason pointed out, if you wanted to actually talk to somebody, it was like hard. It was a pain in the ass to actually talk to somebody.
Yeah, you actually had to think and plan ahead.
Technology, take two.
So for the technology segment, you know what I think would be really awesome to do?
What would that be?
I think what we should do is record this part in like really good quality sound, and then have the recorder battery die so that the next 10 minutes or so is in really bad quality.
Oh, yeah, because that never happens anymore.
Not in real life.
Because technology is so awesome.
Yeah, technology is great. Batteries, AA batteries, those are the shiznit.
Right, exactly. AA batteries.
Yeah. So let's go ahead and do that now.
Yeah, let's do that.
So as you guys know, this is a good technology segment. I'm Brian White.
I'm Jason Jones.
And Jason came up with a great topic, and that was how much communication technology has changed, specifically phones.
In our lifetime.
Now, when I first met you, if I wanted to get a hold of you, what would I do?
You'd call my house,
mm-hmm.
and if I wasn't there, my mom would say, he's not here.
Right, and that was assuming you had call waiting.
Right. If my sister was on the phone
for
with her
for
boyfriend, all you got was a, remember this, people? A busy tone.
Busy signal.
Some people out there don't even know what that is.
If you hear it now, you think, uh-oh, something's horribly wrong. Is the network down? And maybe it is.
Right.
Because that's not a thing anymore. And it was great because your sister would get one of those really long cords so she could wander the house. And that wasn't even enough. She'd get a little coupler.
Yes.
And then a second 20-footer.
Right. So the one downstairs especially. You could walk down the hallway. I think she would use the bathroom talking to her friend and come back. And the cord would go underneath the bathroom door. And they're still talking. You know? And the cord was just part of it. And remember the cord, too. You knew when you had, like, a sister or a mom in the house because the cord was always, like, mangled. You had to get a new one every 2 or 3 years. All coiled up, would be bent in weird shapes from being underneath doors or hiding in the closet when you're not supposed to be on the phone.
It looked like a slinky that a toddler played with.
Right, exactly. Just completely mangled. So you'd need to get a new one every once in a while.
Yeah. So getting in touch with people was hard. And then technology struck. No longer just doctors and drug dealers.
Yes. Now your average 16-year-old could afford to get a pager.
A pager.
Changed everything.
And a lot of parents would get them for their kids because you want to be able to find your kid.
Well, and that's the excuse I used so that my parents would let me have one. Because they said only doctors and drug dealers have pagers.
Right. I had to turn 18 and get my own.
Right.
Actually, I was probably 19.
It was kind of like Austin Powers. Like, only sailors use condoms, Vanessa. It's the same concept.
Yep. And it was probably $20 a month for essentially unlimited, but paging people. God, it sucked. Yep. You know, I'd want to get in touch with you, so I'd page you. And then, I don't know what you're doing. You could be in church. You could be
driving.
Oh, God.
You know?
You could be on a 40. You could be on your way back from Canada.
I knew, like, where all the payphones were in the areas that I kind of prowled around. Like, in Kirkland, in Bellevue, near Microsoft. Like, I knew right where one was, and you always had to have quarters on. You were going and buy something and get quarters. And then, like, one time, you know, I'd have a girl that would page me 5 or 6 times. We'd be down at quarters playing video games, and you'd have to go all the way down the block and around and find the payphone. And there's a line because there's a bunch of other guys that have got 25 pages from their girlfriend. You finally get on that phone, and you call her, and she's like, can you give me a Mountain Dew on your way back? So, see, some things haven't changed.
That's just true.
It was a little more inconvenient to be like, honey, pick up some milk. We don't even think about that these days.
Right. How many times have you been at the store and you just get a text?
Yeah.
Grab this. Okay, got it.
My wife just texted me 5 minutes ago before we started the segment. She's at Costco right now. Do you want this? Yes, thank you.
What is this? Does Costco sell it? They've got a great deal on tires. Do you need eight?
Yeah. Yeah. But they're only for a 18-wheeler, so it's a special right now.
It's a good deal. It's a good deal. I bought a 4-pack of windshields a while back.
Yep.
You can never have too many. It's like they say, you cannot have too many.
That's true. You never know when you're going to need another windshield. Might as well just have them in stock, like right there at your house.
But I had a psycho stalker who wasn't even a girlfriend who pulled that endless page deal. I'm driving home from UW, from college, and she pages me. And, of course, I don't call her back because I'm on the highway. And she proceeds to page me another, I'm going to say, 15 times in the time it takes me to get home. And again, this is not a girlfriend. This is a stalker. So I called her, and I said, what in the hell? She said, I just need to talk. I said, look, I'm going to not talk to you right now. She's like, what? Well, you're on the phone. I'm like, no. I cannot reward this behavior.
Right.
I am going to condition you to not do this to me ever again.
Right.
Because I cannot reward bad behavior.
No. And remember, you had different tones you get for your pagers, and then also they'd vibrate. And I remember even in the movie theater, please silence your pagers.
Oh,
that's
wow.
What it used to say.
Wow.
And I remember one time, Greg's pager went off, and we're in a movie, scared the crap out of him, and he elbowed me in the chest so hard I had a bruise on me for like 3 weeks.
That's funny.
Just because he jumped. But that's the thing. That's the only thing that's kind of a remnant from the pager is the vibration in your pocket to notify you something. It's still the same. It's that it's a little motor, and there's a weight on it. And the weight spins, and that causes the whole thing to vibrate. It's an offset weight on a little tiny motor.
Well, actually,
that hasn't changed.
No, it has. I actually got mine balanced. So
right.
So it's much smoother now. It doesn't,
right. You don't even know.
Right. Well, it doesn't shake. It just spins.
Right.
So it's nice that I've got it balanced.
Right. Absolutely.
Yeah. That yeah. is super useful.
You're super silent.
It's especially silent.
Yeah.
So then, pagers, you know, those were a pain in the ass. And really, only guys had them for some reason.
Yeah, that's true. I think none of my girls that I knew at the time had them. It was just...
No sisters, no
girlfriends. Yeah, I mean, kind of late in the game they kind of finally did, but it was a while.
Yeah.
They were more into talking. They're trying to get a hold of you to talk to you about something.
Sure.
But even for him and I, if we needed to get a hold of each other, you know, before, at first when we started doing, like, movies and stuff together, you'd have to call my house and just hope that I'm home. Or I would let you know, call me tomorrow at 5 and I'll be here.
Right.
Like, probably, I mean, our parents and grandparents had to do that in the 60s. It's not like, you know, and then the answer machine changed everything after that for a while, so you could do that. Or if the principal called, I could erase it before my parents got home.
Right.
You know, that
right.
worked too.
I tried that. They just kept calling until they reached an adult.
Right. But that changed a lot of how we worked
sure
together
did.
Because you could, if you had an idea for something to change in the script,
right.
this was a whole new ballgame.
I could actually reach a person
right.
on purpose.
You would page me and wherever I'm at, I could get to a phone and we could have a discussion about what we wanted to change or do. Where before that, you would just have to wait until I'm around.
Yeah.
We were right at that point where we were able to drive cars and
right.
the pager came out. So it was like the perfect time for our age
right.
and our era.
And what was especially fun is, so then phones came around. Late
90s. They were affordable now.
They were fine. That's true. They'd existed since, gosh, the 80s.
Yeah.
But who wants to carry a satchel or, you know, a car phone? A car phone.
Once again, doctor or drug dealer.
It had to be mounted in your car because it was too big. It was just
right.
too big. And, yeah, they finally became affordable in, like, 95, 96-ish, I got a cell phone, and I was paying $30 a month
yeah.
for 30 minutes.
Oh, that's right, too. I remember because the price of having a phone instead of a pager, for $10 more a month, you were getting a phone that you could talk to.
Right.
And for that, for me, it was like, okay, I'm done with the pager, because for $10 more a month, and I remember there were some pager services were almost the same price at the end of pagers.
Sure, the two ways.
Yeah.
Yeah.
At the end, that the price was almost the same as just having a phone.
And then the cell phone prices came down to $30 a month for 60 minutes, nights and weekends free.
Yeah.
And nights and weekends free, all of a sudden you could actually use your phone.
Yeah. I mean, and for a long time, and talk, and no long distance, and that really changed
Huge.
Things.
No long distance. Long distance, for those of you under the age of... I'm going to say 30-ish.
Oh, wow. 30? But it's true.
If you're under the age of 30, you may not know what a long-distance call is.
Yeah.
And the idea is, if you lived in San Francisco and you wanted to call New York, you might be paying 20, 30 cents a minute. Now, if you were in Everett and wanted to call Linwood, which is only 10 miles away, you might be paying 20 to 30 cents a minute.
Long distance. That's a big scam. That's how they made their money, was
really
this long-distance baloney. Because we're in the same freaking state. I remember calling, Bellevue and calling my parents in Bothell. It's a half an hour drive. Long distance?
Yeah.
Come on.
There were places where it would be a 15-minute drive and it'd be long distance. It'd be cheaper to go visit them than to call them.
Yeah, and when you got, your phone and I got mine, I don't know about you, but I dropped my landline. I dropped it. Why am I going to pay more for this? And the funny thing is, they had a study, a demographic of people that first got cell phones that were in their 20s, dropped their landline. And until recently, that was up until, I think 30 or 35 and above still had a landline, even, 5 years ago.
So it's fun. When it comes to landlines, technically, my stepdad, I'd say my parents, but my mom has passed, they still have a landline. It's not actually a landline. It's Vonage.
Right.
And I, in the house, technically have a landline. It's through T-Mobile at home. It's like 10 bucks. Everybody I know with a landline, how are the old carriers still in business? I don't know anyone who uses
business. The only places that use landlines now are business.
Well, even Boeing uses Vonage.
Oh, yeah, I believe it.
Yeah, because think of how many...
Now, I'm sure, whatever service, my company that I work for has, we have people call us all the time to get appointments and set up for the work I do.
Yeah.
So everybody in the front has a old school phone that's hooked up to a landline. But other than that...
Yeah. Yeah, I don't know who would have it. I don't know. Because the price just didn't make sense. When I got rid of my landline, right. I'd moved into a house. I had a roommate at my old apartment. I moved into a house, and I called to cancel the old phone number, and they said, don't you need service? I was like, no, it's long distance to call my work. It's long distance to call my family. I'm not going to pay 30 bucks a month for a phone that I can only use to order pizza.
And you never used it anyways. You have a cell phone. You never need it.
Right. And I had 1,600 minutes for 70, 80 bucks
a
month.
And I heard the argument, it's security if the power goes out and everything. But I remember a couple times over the years since I've just had a cell phone for... God, almost 20 years now.
Mm-hmm.
2002, so 16 years. Haven't even had a landline. When the power went out, my phone worked, but I remember at my friend's house, the landlines were down.
Well, and if you've got cordless phones, which now everybody does, when the power's out, they're out.
Yeah, they're out. You can't do anything about it. But all the cell towers have generators now, so it lasts quite a while.
Right.
You got to find a way to charge your phone in your car. But that whole thing about the security of having a landline, it's obviously, that's kind of gone out the window.
Yeah.
It has.
So what kind of cell phone did you have?
My first, I don't know the model, but it was the Nokia, through VoiceStream at the time. And it was about this size of a Twinkie. In fact, that if you put the yellow cap, because you could change the colors, it was like a Twinkie that you could dial. And it had a little 1-inch LCD black and white screen that was backlit with one little green LED.
Right.
And that was about it. The problem with it, it was so cool. I could call people, like you said, nights and evenings. I could call. Don't worry about long distance. When it's the shape and size of a Twinkie, it doesn't really fit in your jean pockets very well. It's wintertime or something, you have a jacket, it was okay. But then when I started clothes shopping, I was trying to find something that maybe had the cargo pockets or something, so I could actually put it in somewhere and keep it. What? It's no recording?
You know what? We're using camera sound. I can't fucking do this a third time.
So sorry for the break there. Apparently, you'll notice the sound quality just got better. How about that? It's a free upgrade.
Yes.
Oh, for the love.
Speaking of technology, then there's always downfall. So, I was just talking about my phone. It was great, but it was the size of a Twinkie and you couldn't fit it anywhere. So that was my first phone. What did you have for your first phone?
Well, I don't remember what my first phone was. Maybe it was an Ericsson, maybe it was a Sony, and that was, and at one point I think they merged. My first digital phone I know was a Sony that had the little earpiece would click up to answer, which is
it was like a gimmick, you know.
Yeah, and it was,
they had them in the movies, they'd show, look how cool this is.
It was huge. It was absolutely huge. But the first real, you know, decent digital phone I had was when I switched from, I want to say I was with AT&T and I switched to VoiceStream, and it was a Nokia. And I remember one day I was driving and I had it in my visor, and I'd forgotten that I'd put it in the visor, and I turned the corner and it went out the window at like 25, 30 miles an hour.
Yeah, that was kind of a new thing for people to deal with now, as their phone launched out the car.
So I went back and I picked it up and I put it back together and it worked.
Wow.
All that happened is the battery case came off, the battery came out, it didn't even break. The corners were roughed up, but the damn thing
worked. They were still pretty robust because you didn't have a big glass screen yet. The glass was 10% of the phone.
Right.
You know?
It was plastic. And it was plastic, yeah. Yeah.
Then the next phase, at least for me, for phones, was a really tiny one.
They got smaller and smaller.
Really
and smaller.
Small. And it had a color screen on it now.
My first small one was the Nokia. I want to say it was like an 8290 or a 90. It might have been a 9150.
Yeah.
And they weren't super reliable. I went through a few before I said, okay, no more.
Yeah,
that
Sony Ericsson thing was a piece of junk too. The buttons would quit working.
Oh.
But that, speaking of, was texting. Remember when you first texted, it was T9. So when I was first texting people and finally got into it, it was a real pain in the butt at first. It was a learning curve. But I got really good at going A, B, C, and going through all of them to text somebody until they came out with the predictive texting later on.
Yeah, so cat would be 222, wait, 2, wait, 7777.
And there are some people now that are so young, they don't remember this, but there's some of you out there that do, and you probably haven't thought about that in a long time.
And that wasn't even T9. That was the one step before T9. Yeah, that was the one step before T9. T9 was when you would then spell cat 227.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, so that was a whole new ball game. But once you got used to that, it was faster. Because I remember I'd have like a girlfriend that was like, she would text me back so fast. And I'm like, how are you doing this?
Right.
Like, you are a master.
Right. And, God, you just blow up your phone. My friend's ex-girlfriend would haunt me to try and get information on what Mike is doing and what he's up to and where he's at and who he's with. And I was like, oh, come on, Crystal, leave me alone.
And with technology, you still have psycho hosebies that just switched up the game from paging to crazy, crazy text, crazy, crazy, hobie, crazy, crazy, crazy. Then later on, if you got a landline or you got messages or anything, you could just erase that. You know?
Right.
Or I'm saying earlier on. But then later on, you can't get away from it. Like,
right. Too many methods of communication. So then,
crazy hoe in your pocket.
The fun thing that happened right before smartphones, mobile web.
Oh,
so you got
God.
you had your Razor.
Yeah, I had my Razor
with a color screen.
Yes,
and games. You could play games,
and it was slim. You could fit it in your pocket. Slim. That was the key.
Yeah, and it was. It was a great phone. It really was. It was kind of pricey, but it was good.
Cool looking.
It was very hip. But the mobile web, oh God, the mobile web. I never successfully used it. You tried.
I tried a couple times, especially on like sports. I do like NFL or whatever. And it was like looking at I don't know. I can't describe it. Like you're like, oh, there's a website for this. And half the time it wouldn't load wherever you are.
Right.
B, it's going to go crazy with your data.
Right.
It took forever to load. And usually, I mean, it was like 8-bit. Like, it was a step back. You might as well just have a DOS prompt come up on the screen.
Right.
It was just so hokey.
So you've got 4G or LTE. What speed was your data connection?
The first one?
Yeah.
1G.
Yes. So I didn't actually use my mobile web. What I did is this new program came out for T-Mobile where you could tether. So what you would do is they'd give you this funky adapter that would plug into your Nokia and plug into your laptop.
Oh, wow.
Oh my God. And I don't mean it would plug into a USB. I mean, it would plug into like a little funky serial port.
Oh yeah.
I don't even remember but anyway, and it was this weird cord. And I said, great. So how much data do I get? They go, it's unlimited. Unlimited data from your phone to your laptop. I go, great. What's the speed? And he said, 3.9K. So it wasn't a 56K dial-up, which you'd never get anyway. You'd probably get 36 or 27. Yeah. This was, in theory, about 6% of a dial-up. And I said, 3.9K? Are you...
Right. And is that because the processing power was so limited in the phone?
It's because the network was too slow. Because all the... Basically, I was using a text messaging service to browse the web.
Yeah, I mean, somebody that has more smarts might be able to know more about what changed in that. Like, they offered it, but it was the same as offering nothing. It was completely useless. Nobody used it. I gave up on it.
I would use it at the office. I'd keep my laptop connected to the internet through that.
Right.
Because for a while at my office, they didn't have a dedicated modem line for me. And so I would use that. And my first bill came, and it was the very first month it was offered. So it was so screwed up. And what it did is, it burnt through all my bucket minutes, and then so then any call I made, I had to pay for.
Oh, yeah.
So when my bill came, instead of it being, it would have been probably about $100 when you figure all the taxes.
And when that happened, it was a shock. Like, you'd get it and be like, oh, my God. Like,
the bill was, I want to say, $4,000.
Oh, my God.
And
what?
Well, I called them, and I'm like, yeah, you need to fix this. And he looked at, or no, it wasn't 4,000. It was well in the hundreds, though.
Right, but it's something, it was something completely asinine, like, yeah, when somebody's water line breaks and they find out, like, 2 months later, well, that they have this crazy
bill. But I called him, and I said, no, all my data should be unlimited. And he goes, oh, I see what happened is your data accidentally used your phone minutes, and then your phone minutes counted additional.
Right.
And so he fixed it. But he looked at it, he's like, I have never seen someone use this many minutes. I go, how many is it? And he's like, it was like 14,000 minutes or something.
Wow, and that was because of the data, right?
That was because of the data. Right. The phone would be connected for, 10 hours straight when I'm at the office.
Yeah, and they got more powerful and you need more data, and that's never going to stop. It's like, it just, the more data you can get, for a while, you could get unlimited data even in 3 or 4G, but then they're like, okay.
Right.
You need to do that. We need to have you pay for it because we don't have enough processing power to get you that data.
Really,
so we need everybody to cool it.
They really do. But they, anyway.
Well, they caught up, but then they're like, hey, we're still making money off this, so let's just keep going.
Well, so T-Mobile for a while had an unlimited data plan, but it didn't include tethering. So data to me is useless without tethering because I can't, the idea is if my internet goes out and I need to upload the podcast, I can use my phone.
Right.
But the unlimited data doesn't count for that because they know with a computer you could burn through.
Right.
So much.
Exactly. So, I mean, phones were still kind of a phone, and they finally transitioned into, like you said, then you had the tethering and everything else. And then finally, I had a Sidekick, if you guys remember that. It was stupid the way it flipped open. The only reason why I got it is that I could text with my thumbs on an actual keyboard now.
A tactile keyboard.
Right. And so that was the main reason why I got it.
Yeah.
And then I was still leery. They were starting to come out with phones that were like the iPhone with the full screen that you could tap on. And I tried my buddies, but it didn't work very good for my fat thumbs to click on that. I wanted buttons I could actually push down and feel it.
Well, I remember my first smartphone was the T-Mobile G1. And I felt like a late adopter at the time to smartphones. And the G1, it was one of those deals where it would slide open like a Sidekick.
Yeah.
And you'd have the keyboard.
Yeah.
And I was like, man, I am just sold on this. And it wasn't until J-Dog got out of, got to an actual touchscreen phone. He's like, no. This is the future.
Yeah.
Don't hold out for,
And about the same time when you finally got a full screen like that, too, is then when finally you had 2G came out. And then you finally had a real website that you could go to. When Google came out, you could actually bring up a real website. And it would work.
Yeah. And I want to say that was already 3G around that point.
Yeah.
Because
2G, it's like they skipped over it. I swear it was like 1 and then 3 is what they seem to offer.
And 3G is not bad. T-Mobile's, have you ever had a chance to use their international roaming?
I did. I had T-Mobile and I got to use it when I was over in London.
Yeah. And what did it cost you?
Oh, an arm and a leg.
Oh, do you know what it costs now?
No.
Nothing.
Oh, wow.
Calls are 10 cents a minute, and data is free at 3G speeds. Texting is free, and if you're at a Wi-Fi hotspot, it's all free.
Yeah.
Any Wi-Fi. So I've gone to Germany, I've gone to Thailand, I've been in Korea, and I come home, and my bill has a premium on it of, I'm going to say, $6, $7. It's just...
Wow, that's...
But, it's the internet.
Right. It's everything's gotten cheap, and they've kind of had it. They've got it all figured out and situated, and everything's kind of settled down now.
Yeah.
So.
Conversely, if I try to use my goddamn phone in Montana, I only get 25 megs of data included. Yeah. And
that's why I still have like a Blockbuster would survive out there, because there's some places that you go through that you don't have the streaming like we have here.
It's just, well, they're like, well, we don't have a network there. I'm like, that's not my problem. It's a coast-to-coast phone. So she goes, okay, you can buy another 25 megs. Or I don't remember how much it was, but it was not a huge amount of data.
Right.
And I paid, and this is like a year ago, and I must have paid $20-$30 extra. And that was on a Thursday. And Friday morning, I get up to use my phone, and I can't use data. I'm like, what the hell? Well, you know what happens Friday mornings? That's when they update all your apps.
Oh.
So my automatic updates burnt through the $30 in data I bought.
Oh, no.
And it's like, oh, T-Mobile, you sons of bitches. I can use my phone in Thailand for free.
Well, I'm wondering, too, like, if you live out in Podunk where you just can't get the internets at as fast speed, is 4G, they've gotten it up to, so somebody that's living in some small Podunk town and Montana is using his phone for the interwebs all the time because it's faster than what he can get plugged into his house because they haven't caught up to it yet.
Right.
You know?
Yep. And it's definitely fast enough. When I've had an outage, I've downloaded streaming videos like through let's not say torrents, but torrents.
Yeah.
And the speed is great. It's just the cap is too low.
Yeah.
So it used to be if I wanted to reach you, if I called your house and you weren't there, or I got a busy signal,
tough luck.
I would my next option was drive around and look for you.
Right.
Unless it was before teenagers had cars.
Before we could drive. Yeah.
And then you'd hop on your bicycle.
Right.
And you won't find people that way.
No,
that's not effective.
It's changed so much. Like even, and it was right at our age group that everything changed, and it kind of changed as we grew up, and it was a necessity right from the get-go. Like, and we didn't even think about it. It was just there. This is nice that this happens to be here right now at this time and age in our lives. So it was like, Jason, Brian up the street's on the phone for you to you. Paging me, and then I'm calling you back, and we discuss that too.
And the other nice thing is
texting to actually calling and telling somebody live to.
The other nice thing is I bought DVD players for the van, the old van, and it was great because for once the kids would be quiet. I will never buy DVD players for the van again.
Right.
Well,
you can't sell them at a garage sale. You just hand them the phone.
Right. Right. And each kid's going.
Or they're on their own phone.
Their own phone.
Yeah.
And that's the other nice thing is, you know, even 5-10 years ago, if you wanted your kid to have a cell phone, you're talking at least $30 a kid.
Yeah, and that's expensive. And
yeah,
do they really need this phone? Well, now it's like, if they're messing with your stuff, then like even on, my niece has got a hold of my YouTube, so I get all this Minecraft stuff that just bombards my phone.
Right.
So it's like, well, you just got to get your own and have you have your own account because she's using it so much now at 9.
But for my kids, we didn't get them service. We just got them phones.
Right.
So if they want to reach us, all they have to do is get on their buddy's Wi-Fi.
Right.
It's perfect. We've not only did the cell phone carrier eliminate the landlines, now the internet is eliminating the cell phone carriers.
Yeah. And I mean, how often do you use your phone as a phone? Really rare.
I mean, the number of minutes I use in a month it's never an hour.
Yeah. I mean, I see my wife, like, she'll call and talk to one of her friends in Florida for a while. Her mom. That's kind of a thing. But for me as a guy, like, I call, like, if I need to call, I'm calling. I'm like, yeah, I'll see you there. That's great. See you later.
Yeah.
But most of the time I'm texting or what are you doing?
But if you really want to talk, you know, J-Dog pointed out that what he would use, what he would have used to contact family, he now uses Skype.
Yeah.
Because if you want to talk to your parents once a week, or, you know, his wife's parents do not live in the U.S.
Right.
She Skypes with them.
Yeah.
So let me get this straight. It's basically free for a live video phone call.
Right. Why are you going to pay for that when you can get a live? You know, military, it's great for families like that. I've never really used Skype that much.
I really haven't either.
But I could see if I was in a different country or had family far away, like close family, it's an awesome thing to be able to have. If somebody's over in the Middle East, you know, on a military thing, you can talk to your kids once a week. I mean, that's where it's really at. So, but I mean, calling I'm not going to Skype Brian at 6 in the morning to find out what we're doing. I mean, we look like hell.
Well, and that's the thing is, you'd want to schedule. Skype, you got to schedule.
Yeah.
Because normally, if I have pants on, they're on my head.
Right.
As is tradition.
Right, exactly. Or it's like if I have really bad morning goat hair, and I don't want anybody to see that. So I much rather just text them.
Well, that's why I shave my goats before the lovemaking.
Well, that's an entirely different subject. That goes back in the old days about the well-greased yak, well-shaven, but that's an entirely different subject matter.
Yeah. Well, I think that's great, and I think we can go ahead and cap it right there for technology for this week.
Yep, technology.
Technology. Look
how much it's changed since we were in junior high school and the way it is now.
Where have the years gone? Where? Find them.
They're in the phone.
Well, the time has come, my friends. This week I ran a little long, thanks to the good graces of Jason V. Jones, Jazz Vajonia. Glad you joined us. Hey, I'm not even going to have time for a closing thought, so let's just wrap it up. Follow me around the web. Glossynews.com/podcast has links to Reddit, Facebook, YouTube, Libsyn, iTunes, all that good stuff, and so much more. And by that I mean probably very little more and even a little bit less. Closing thought? No, who needs it? Segment bumpers and backing music by Greg the Hero, link in the description. Couple songs, the intro and the outro by Kevin McLeod of Incompetech.com. Good work, Kevin. Love it. Good stuff. What else? I don't know. Let's find out next week as, you know, the quality keeps ramping up. And by the way, for those of you watching, you'll notice that this segment, the segment you're watching right now, has a brand new graphic. Wonderful, beautiful, love it. Good thing those crackheads burgled my office so I could, you know, lose the majority of my gear and replace, you know, a 3-camera setup with one slightly better camera. I don't know. I guess that's my closing thought is, thank gods for crackheads as they pertain to also having insurance. Okay, guys. You know, if you're hearing this on Sunday, you need to stop listening and hurry up and get to my birthday party. And if you're hearing this on Monday, where the hell were you yesterday? I was waiting for you. Oh, you've let me down. You've let me down so tragically. All right, guys, I will talk to you next week, next Sunday for the early subscribers, next Monday for the regulars, and you know what? Stay safe and let's talk soon.